Glad that you are here this morning. Hopefully you can hear me. I can definitely hear you. So, wow, what a day today is, right? A beautiful day. Let's just be thankful that it's not raining. This is the first Sunday, I believe, in this year that it has not rained on us. So, hopefully I see some of you back from your sicknesses and illnesses. So hopefully that everything is well with you. And we just want to invite you to worship with us today. And thank you for being here. And I want to open up with a word of prayer. And then I have a very special presentation to make this morning. So let's have a word of prayer together. Father, we just come before you, Lord. We thank you for this time. Father, we thank you for all of the blessings of life that you have given us, Lord. And Father, we thank you for the beauty of this day. God, that we can come to worship you in all of your glory and all of your splendor. And Lord, we just pray that you will get praise, honor, and glory out of our time together today. Lord, we just again want to lift up these to you today, Lord, that are sick, that are struggling right now. God, I pray for your Holy Spirit, Lord, to be amongst us today. Lord, we love you. Lord, we praise you today. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. 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 I have a presentation that I want to share with you today. I want to ask Thomas to come up here, and he can bring his mom and dad if he wants to. Brandon and Jennifer. Jen, as I call her. And Thomas. We got to unstrap him. I was told this morning that he's already in rare form. He indoctrinated Brandon this morning with a little spit up, right? Is that right? Praise the Lord, then that's good. I learned when mine were very young that I always kept a spare suit in the office because I always had one. Come on up here, you guys, and I'll just have you stand right here. This is Thomas. This is Brandon and Jen. And today we are... they want to dedicate their child, and what we do as part of our dedication service is a lot of people say, well, Pastor, this has nothing to do with the salvation of the child. We hope that it will. Eventually, we're dedicating Thomas today, and we're hoping that one day, by leading of Thomas in the faith, that one day he comes to know the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And so, I don't know if y'all know, very interesting, I didn't know, but you named them Thomas and Philip, and so I think you were going with the disciples and that kind of idea, but do you know what the name Thomas means?
I don't.
You don't? Well, good. I'm going to share it with you today. It means one of equality, and I got to thinking about a verse of Scripture for him today, and I don't know of another verse of Scripture that would fit than... John 3:16, for God so loved the world, the whole world, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. And that's the verse of Scripture. I just thought about it, one of equality, and what a great verse of equality, then God loved us all equally so that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for us. And so what I want to do is I want to challenge you guys. And I want to ask you a question that you have received probably one of the most precious gifts that God can ever give to anybody. And with that, there is great responsibility. And great responsibility in raising Thomas. And I want to know if you, Brandon and Jen, will promise to, in the best of your ability, raise Thomas in the fear and admonition of the Lord. And would you raise him in the faith of the Christian faith, and hopefully one day that discipling him to become a follower of God? Do you promise to do that?
Yes,
you do. I want to give you a verse of Scripture to kind of challenge you into that.
Okay.
And it's a verse of Scripture that's very, very popular. Proverbs chapter 22 and verse 6. Train up or raise up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is not when he is old, he will not flee from it. And that's kind of your challenge as parents today, to raise Thomas in the way that he should go. That's all right. There we go. That's a good deal. That's all right. That's okay. That's just a sign of love there. All right. In church, we have a responsibility as well. And so our responsibility is to walk beside Brandon and Jen and to partner with them in helping to raise Thomas in that fear and admonition of the Lord. And so, church, we are held responsible for that too. And if you will agree with me and these two and partner with them in raising Thomas in the faith, I want to ask you to stand up, if you will. And this, I love this. This is a great, because you get to see your church family standing up and standing with you in this decision. And church, we have a verse of scripture, and this verse of scripture I found the other day, and I love this verse of scripture. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 15, and it says, "And now from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Jesus Christ." And that's our job, is to help this couple, help these parents into raising Thomas in and discipling him in the faith. And we do that by the Word of God and teaching the Word of God. So if you'll look over to the right of you, one day he's going to be sitting right there with all the rest. Well, these guys will be hopefully be moved on, but he will be sitting right there along with those guys. And we have just such a wonderful children's department and wonderful people to help train and teach in that. We got a Bible for you and a certificate. Aww. And a book for you. And that is just, that book will have everything you need to know about parenting.
Okay.
Let me tell you this. That book may not, but I can promise you this book does. And so hold on to that. Let me have a word of prayer with y'all. I love y'all. Thank you so much for letting me be a part of this day. And all of the family up here on the front row, man, you know they're visitors when they sit in the front row, right? Right? You have to, we have a saying around here, you have to come early to get a back row, okay? So anyway, let me have a word of prayer with us, and then we'll continue our worship today. Father, we just come before you. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this beautiful life and this miracle of life that we see in Thomas, Lord. And thank you for Brandon and for Jen. And Lord, we just pray for this family. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to strengthen them today. And Lord, that you will just give them that excitement that they have for this beautiful gift that you've given them. But Lord, that great responsibility that we have to raise a child up in the way that he should go. And Lord, the way is that the gospel of Jesus Christ, the truth of the God's word. And Father, we as a church, Father, we just wonderfully just exciting about what's going on today. And Lord, we want to partner with this family. And Lord, as we stand here today, Lord, we stand and wanting to make disciples of all nations. And Lord, we just love you. And we thank you today for what you have done. We thank you for what you're going to do. And in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said amen. Amen. While they are making their way to their seats, I want to ask that you just turn and welcome somebody today. And come and introduce yourself to these folks. Thank y'all.
Thank you.
Oh,
you. I hope you recognize that. We don't belong here, praise God, but we're here for such a time as this. But one day, the trump will resound, and boom, we're caught up in heaven. So we're going to have some a little bit of enjoyment about heaven. You want to sing with us? All right, come on, Ricky, throw it down. Sing with us.
Well, some glad morning when this life is over. Pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. My faith on heaven's table land. A higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'm praying to end I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land.
Since Jesus came into my heart, but to
Jesus came into my heart. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul, for which world I have sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since
as a man, Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, O Christ. What a beautiful name.
What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is, nothing compares to this.
What a beautiful name it is,
the name of Jesus. Didn't want us in heaven with you, so Father, you sent heaven down. Sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the bolts to sin and grave. Heavens are roaring, praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again.
It is worthy of our praise. One day we'll be with Him. One day that day is coming. A glorious day when it's revealed to us. Our blinded eyes are done and we can see Him face to face. Listen.
One day when heaven was filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. Word became flesh and light shine among us, His glory revealed. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified. Stretched out on a tree, He took the nails for me. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified. Oh, glorious day. but living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified.
With all creation I sing praise to the King. Come forward. Let us pray. God, just thank you for today. Thank you for the service that we've already had. I just thank you for parents like Brandon and Jen that responsibility and been willing to dedicate their baby that we know special blessings from you on. God, we just ask you to go with everyone that's hurting. We ask you to special blessings for the families down in Florida, for everything that they're going through. We just ask you to go with the this morning with, as we take up our offering, that everything that we bring in will be used for your glory. And we just ask you to go with Jason as he brings us a message. We just thank you for everything. I ask your name. Amen.
All this pain, all this suffering.
So you are sensing a theme today of home, heaven, those kind of things. And you know, heaven is a prepared place for a prepared person. It is not by accident that heaven, and you know what we sing about heaven, we think about heaven, we talk about heaven, and you know, a lot of people say, well, you know, that's one day when we get to heaven, but you know what, we're preparing for that right now. You know, so I hope that your heart is overflowing today with thoughts of heaven. Now, that being said, there is a heaven. And there is a place prepared, but like I said, heaven is a prepared place for a prepared person. And we have to prepare ourselves to go to heaven. So if you've got your Bibles, I want you to turn to the book of Romans, chapter 10. Romans is the church's, the doctrine of the church, so to speak. Romans is a highly, deeply theological book. Not that the other books of the Bible are not theological speaking, but man, Romans is very, very deep. And a lot of times, if you're just kind of skimming through and reading through, you'll miss it. And I want to talk to you today about the mission and the missionary challenge. The missionary challenge. The church has a challenge. How many of you like challenges? Raise your hand. You like challenges. Some of you don't like challenges. I love challenges. I love the underdog. I love the underdog. It is great to see, and if you've watched any of the Olympics lately, it's just, you get to, I was watching the other day, the jump, the ski jump. Man, that, it, to me, is fascinating how they can go down a ramp that is 350 feet high. It's 50 foot taller than the Statue of Liberty. And they go straight down there. And then when they leap off the end of that thing, they get like that, and they turn their skis like this. Are y'all familiar with that? Have y'all been watching that? And then they, whoom, then they jump, and then I don't know how they keep from just killing themselves doing it. I was watching it. So, and I, you know, I love the Olympics. I love to watch the Olympics. But what really got me was they start, this athlete, it was the women's ski jump, And she gets out on the edge there, and she sits down on the bench, and they're waiting on the light to turn green, and it kept turning red because of the wind was going back and forth, and they were waiting to before they let her go. And then they start telling this girl's story. I think she is from a total different country than the U.S., and so I'm sitting there listening to her story, and they talk about how she's had three knee surgeries. And she just got over a total knee replacement some 8 months ago. And they showed her in rehab and how she was getting, the doctor said she would never walk normal again, much less do a ski jump off a 350-foot ramp. And then they said, and this got it right here, this is her last Olympic Games because she is 40 years old. Immediately. That was who I was rooting for. These other ones are 19, 20 years old, and here comes Grandma up there. Woo! Man, I was on fire, man, 40 years old. And I'm sitting there thinking, man, this is great. And I didn't care what country she was. I was rooting for her. I wanted her to win the gold. I don't know what she did, but man, it got me even more excited. And then the light turned green, and she went down that ramp, and I'm going, come on, come on, come on. I have no idea how they score these things. I have no idea how they judge these things. I was just hoping she would and just fly out of the country because I wanted her to do good. She was the underdog, you know, and people on her team. I mean, she was the oldest one on the team by 20 years, and they called her Grandma. You know, I thought, man, this is great. I love the underdog. I love a challenge. Don't tell me I can't do something. I mean, I'm the one that if you put wet paint, do not touch, I'm going to be the one that does this right here. I like a challenge. I love a challenge. I don't like to lose.
All right.
I don't know if anybody just gets into a game or something and go, you know what? I just love to lose. I don't like to lose. If it's checkers, I'm going to annihilate you. And the whole time I'm doing it, as I'm jumping, I'm going, look at this. Look at this. Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead and make that move right there. I will do it. Our family is quite competitive, and we got in a game of Jenga a couple of weeks ago and put it out there on the table. Y'all don't know what that is. It's about these wooden blocks, and you got to move those things out. And I am telling you one thing, that I don't lose. And the problem is I've got one that's just like me, and my daughter hates to lose. And so when you get me and her in the same room, what happened is Tracy and Hayden have already quit and gone downstairs like an hour, and me and Mallory are sitting there going, all right, come on, you make a move. All right. We love a challenge. I think that's why our society loves a challenge. That's why it's fueling these reality shows. American Idol. I mean, I saw that it's coming back out for 150th season. I mean, literally, really? I mean, have we not gotten enough American Idol? Don't answer that. I have. But, I mean, Survivor. All of these kind of things, the Voice, all of these reality shows, we like a challenge. But do you know what? Can I tell you this? The church has been given a challenge as well. And here's the challenge that the church is given, and it's outlined in Romans chapter 10. So I want you to look at it with me, if you will. Romans chapter 10, starting with verse number 13. Many of you probably have heard this passage of Scripture, but here's what it says. For whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. First of all, I want to stop right there, and I want to tell you that we have a challenge. And the challenge is this, that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. It doesn't say might be. It doesn't say could be. It says will be saved. Now, let me go on and go, let's read on. Verse 14. How then shall they call upon him who they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him who they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring glad tidings of good things. However, they did not all heed the glad tidings. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. That right there is our challenge. That is our challenge. And I've called it a missionary challenge. And I want to see, and I want to kind of break that down this morning with you. And I want you to see a couple of things about this challenge. Number one, I want you to see the message of the challenge. Look at it again. Now to do that, I want you to go just a little bit before. Go to Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. Okay, just on the other side of the page, if you're in oh, by the way, it's page 986 in my Bible. So, I mean, if you're following along here. All right, verse number 9. That if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in what? Say it with me. Salvation. Okay, let me show you the message of the challenge. Listen, the message of the challenge is verse number 13. For whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. That word saved there, salvation, we have the message of salvation. The message is the message that Jesus Christ lived a sinless, he lived a perfect life. He died a cruel death on a cross. God raised him up from the dead, and that is the message of salvation right there. Did you know that Jesus paid the penalty for your sin? Yeah, he paid the penalty for your sin. You deserved death. You deserved a cross. You deserved the shame. You deserved all of that. But Jesus Christ died in your place. He died for you. And we have that message. Listen to this. Christianity is the only religion, so to speak, that has salvation. Yes, we all have the only way. Now you may say, well, wait a minute, Brother Jason. Don't all roads lead to heaven? No, they do not. I'm here today to tell you that. The theology of Oprah Winfrey is hogwash. I'm here today to tell you that there is no other name, there is no other way, there is no other road, there is no other door that leads to heaven but through Jesus Christ. That He is the only way, He is the only truth, and He is the only life. We have that message. Listen, today in our society, we have so many religions out there, and it's confusing people. Do you hear me? It's confusing people. People will come to me and go, well, what about this, or what about that, or what about this religion, or what about that religion? Folks, listen to me. The devil would like nothing better than to confuse you into hell. He would love nothing better to confuse you. Because if you can think that there's another way to heaven but through Jesus Christ, you are sadly mistaken. There's some people that believe that you can do your good works and get to heaven. Folks, you cannot. You cannot. Listen to this. The world has its masses. There is so many people on planet Earth. I saw something a couple of weeks ago, and every time, I'm telling you, every day the statistics change because there are more and more people that are being born every day. Billions of people on planet Earth. Let me tell you this. Billions of people are lost. The world has its masses. Listen to this. We have the message. We have the message for the masses. Jesus Christ is an equal opportunity Savior. He will save you. Now, I want you to go back, and if you don't have this underlined in your Bible, let me just invite you to do that. If not in your Bible, you may say, well, Pastor, I don't write in my Bible. I used to think that as well, and then I began to start doing it, and I love the fact that mine's all messed up and wrote up and all that kind of thing. But here's what I want you to circle this, highlight this. Make sure you've got this plain and straight in your heart and in your Bible right now and in your mind. Look at verse 13. Don't miss it. For whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? Let me just say that one more time. For whoever. It doesn't say that there's just a selected few. It doesn't say that Jesus died for just a few. That verse of Scripture there said whoever. Whoever. You cannot explain that away. Jesus Christ died for everyone. He died so that everyone would come to repentance. Now, does that mean that everybody's going to get saved? No, it doesn't. It doesn't mean that at all. But my question is this. Do you know who's going to get saved and who's not going to get saved? No. That's why we have a missionary challenge to go out and spread the gospel to everybody. That is our job. Whoever. It don't matter what color they are. It don't matter where they're from. It does not matter. Jesus loves them. Jesus loves you. It's a whosoever gospel. I had somebody one time tell me, Pastor, I don't know why you are so out about sharing the gospel with everybody. You know, Jesus only died for just a few folks. I said, really? I had never heard that before. Yeah, didn't you know that? I said, well, can you please show it to me? Because I believe that every verse of Scripture that I hear of, the one I gave to my little buddy down there, Thomas, for God so loved the few that He gave His only begotten Son, that only those folks that God has put His stamp of approval on, or that those folks that all are, how many of you are right-handed in here? Raise your hand. How many of you are, better yet, how many of you here are left-handed? God didn't die for you. No, He didn't. Says it in Scripture, right? I mean, that's absurd. That sounds just crazy, isn't it? Doesn't that sound crazy? You know what? I'm telling you, just because God only died for the right-handed folks, God only died for, let me just tell you this. You take all of that theology and you put it right here in your hand and write it down. Write all that theology down. Rip it out. Throw it away. Cast it away. Because here is the Word of God. The Word of God says whoever. Whoever. I have a shirt that was given to me by a friend of mine. And it says that, and it's, we joke, because my friend good friend of mine. We don't share the same theology. And he gave me a shirt, and it says, and here's what the shirt said: I am a whosoever. And I am. I'm a whosoever. I'm a whoever. I'm a whoever that believes in Jesus. You know why? Because that's what the Word of God says. Okay, so here's I want you to hear the message. The message is Jesus died for you. That's the message. That's the message that we have. If you read the whole book of Romans and go on in and any passage or writings that Paul wrote, Paul said this, that salvation is in Jesus Christ. Salvation is in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. First of all, I want you to understand that you can't say that salvation is only in the death of Jesus Christ, because that's just part of it. Jesus died for your sin, but if Jesus is still dead and we can see the tomb of Jesus and the body of Jesus, then that means your sin has not been dealt with. But because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, hallelujah, our sin has been paid for and has been dealt with and has been overcome. That is the message that we have. That's the message of the challenge. That's the missionary message. Now, let me give you the second one. Let me give you the second one. Not only do we have the message, I want you to see the method. Now, look what Paul does. Don't you just love Paul? Man, I'm going to tell you, I love studying Paul, because Paul is... wow, Paul's deep. But listen to what Paul does. Paul doesn't just come right out and say something. What he'll do is he'll just kind of ask a few questions. And this is what he does. So what Paul does is he gives us the method. And let me just tell you this. The message never changes. Did you hear me? All right, say that with me together. The message never changes. The message of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am Alpha Omega. I'm beginning and end. He said, I was here before everything. He said, and I'll be here when everything's gone. You know what? You can rest assured. You can put your anchor in Jesus Christ, because he doesn't change. The grass will fade away. The flowers will fade. The grass will wither. But the Word of God will never change. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? So with the message never change. Hey, sometimes the methods do. Now, if you don't believe that that's true, if that, you don't believe that the methods change, well, several years ago, they didn't have these electric lights in here. So if you don't believe the method, well, let's shut them down. How about that? How many of you like air conditioning and heat? Y'all like that, don't you? Yeah, because, I mean, they walk into the room, the first thing most people do. I love people. And I love people, especially church folks. It is absolutely amazing, because I'm telling you, you can watch folks, and they walk into the church doors, and they no more get in the church doors, and they start bumping down the heat or turning up the heat. Just, they don't even know yet. It's kind of like eating food. When you eat food, some people don't even eat food, don't even put a morsel in their mouth, and they salt it. Yeah. You don't even know. You don't know if it needs salt or not. But hey, some of you folks, it's the more salt, the better. Yes. Yeah, some of you folks, yeah. Heart attacks waiting to happen. But here's the thing. Here's the thing I want you to see, this right here. The message doesn't change. The method sometimes changes. The method does change. Now look at what Paul says. Look what he says in verse number 14. How then shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? All right? So the message is Jesus Christ died, was buried, rose again. That's the good news. All right? But how in the world are we to get that message out there? We are to give them something to believe in. You can't say, hey, believe in this, believe in that. You got to give somebody something to believe in. I remember talking to somebody one time, and this is what they said. You know, I don't verbally share the gospel. And first of all, let me just say this. The Bible says that we are to verbally share the gospel. We are to share the gospel. And it says, well, you know what, Pastor? I just live a life that others will see my life and will come to know Christ. Let me give you words of advice on that. It is not your life that they are saved by. It is his death. We've got to give people something to believe in. And we've got to share the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Listen to what Paul said. He asked four questions. All right? dealing with the method of this message. How do we get that message out there? How do we fulfill the challenge, the missionary challenge? So, all right, first of all, it says, how are they going to believe in whom they are? How are they going to believe if they've not heard or not, they've not understand who to believe in? Are you sharing Jesus with people? I've heard people say, well, you know what? Come to my church. This church didn't save you. Come hear my pastor. Your pastor didn't save you. Jesus Christ saved you, not the church. I love this church. I love the buildings in this church. I love this church. But I am here today to tell you this church did not save me. A church does not save you. Jesus does. Now look at the second question he gives you. And how shall they believe in him who they have not heard? Well, wait a minute, Pastor. What does that say? Something good's happened. If something good happens to you, it is very, very... I'm in the hallway. I love to hear people in the hallway. I love to hear people in the hallway talking about various things going on in their life. You let a grandbaby do something good, and I'm going to tell you one thing, it is all... y'all throw a parade. Rightfully so. Rightfully so. You should brag about them grandchildren. You know? I love the little bumper sticker I saw. It said, come up close and let me tell you about my grandchildren. I like that a lot. Grandchildren are great. You know, here and you let something happen. Let something happen to your sports team, your favorite sports team. And man, we talk about them, right? We're proud. We talk. Let somebody in here have let somebody in here win the lottery or something. Man, then people are going to talk about that all up and down here. Well, man, the greatest thing that could ever happen to human beings has happened to us if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and we shut up about it. Yeah, I didn't think I'd hear a lot of hallelujahs on that one. That's not one of them amens, that's an oh me, ain't it? That's true. Man, let me tell you about this or let me tell you about that. You got a favorite television show or a great movie? I'm going to tell you. It's funny when a new movie comes out. People are around. Have you seen that new movie? No, well, let me tell you all about it. And they tell you all about the movie. We are more excited about sports and movies than we are about the Savior who loved us and died for us. That's what Paul says. We've got to spread the gospel with our mouth. Now, wait a minute. That's just the second question. Look at the third question. Now, how are they going to hear? There's Jesus that died. You've got the message. All right? And how are they going to understand or believe in somebody that they don't know? And now, how are they going to know about him and believe in him if they haven't heard? Now, listen to this. And how shall they hear without a preacher? Now, before you look up at me and say, yeah, there you go, Pastor. You the man. Huh? Let me just say this. You to men and women too. That's what he's talking about. He's not talking about the office of the preacher, office of the pastor. As a matter of fact, if he was talking about that, Paul would have said, and that's the job of the pastor. He doesn't say that. He says preacher. He says preacher. Let me show you this. And I want to kind of share with you. You've got the message of, you've got Jesus and salvation here. And then you have the hearing and somebody receiving Jesus Christ. There's a missing link between the two. And you know what the missing link is? Me and you. Me and you. That's our job. Did you know that the job of the church is not to make you and me happy? Yeah, I know that is a total... I know some of you are going to leave out of here. You know what? I found it out. I figured it out. When I wake up in the morning... And I breathe a breath of fresh air, that I am going to make somebody mad because I did breathe. You know what? Church is not here to make you happy. Church is here. We exist, not for fellowship, although that is a great byproduct of church, and I believe in fellowship. Don't walk out of here today and say the pastor's against fellowship. I am not. But when fellowship is the main reason the church exists, that's the wrong reason. Okay? Ministry is so vitally important. Ministry is important. Methods are important. But it is not the reason we exist. The reason we exist is to get the message of Jesus Christ to the masses. That's it. That's the reason we exist. We exist to preach the Word of God. How do you preach the Word of God? Now, I'm not talking about standing up in here and preaching. Now, some of y'all could do that. Some of you could. Many of you don't know this or not. But I'm telling you, my family will tell you, Saturday nights, I get very little sleep because I am so worked up, I'm excited, but I'm also scared to death every night. Man, before I walk up here, I am plumb scared. I'm out of my element up here. You don't believe that. You don't believe that. But I am. This is one of those things that I just, when I look back, I think God is doing this into me and through me. That's crazy. Because that's just not who I am. This is so far out of my comfort zone. But here's what I want you to understand something. When you preach, when you share the Word of God, when you are preaching, it is not necessarily 3 points, a poem, an illustration, an invitation. Let's go home. That's not what that means. You study. You know the Word of God. The Word of God is what changes people's hearts. Not my words. My pastor, my mentor in the ministry, he told me, he said, you know what? When you are preaching, he said, you take that responsibility very seriously. Did you know that I'm held responsible for how I lead you? But I'm going to tell you something else. You ready for this? I know. I heard a lot of amens on this one. This one right here, when I pull it back, you guys are going to go, uh-oh. I am responsible for how I lead you, but you are responsible for letting me lead you. Oh, see, that's a different story there. We're all up and going, yeah, amen, Pastor, you're going to stand before God, but you're going to stand before God too. There's a responsibility with that. Now, let me tell you what that means. When you are a preacher, when you are sharing the Word of God, you are responsible for sharing the message of Jesus Christ to that person. You may say, well, Pastor, I can't do what you do. That's all right. That's okay. That's not what that passage is saying. That passage is saying is that we have the opportunity, we have the responsibility to share the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are that link. And the problem is, in today's church, we are the weakest link. Because there's a stark difference between Jesus dying on the cross and people coming to know Jesus, and we are missing it somewhere in the middle. Do you think that God needs you? No, He doesn't. He does not need you. That's what makes grace and love and mercy so important. He doesn't need us, but He chooses to love and use us. Isn't that neat? He chooses to love you. He chooses to use you. And then Paul mentions the last, look at it. Look at that last question he mentioned. Now, how can they have a preacher unless he's sent? Do you see that? Unless they are sent. That's where the rubber meets the road this morning. You see, we have a missionary challenge, and that missionary challenge is this. We have a message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we have a responsibility and a challenge to meet that, to bring that, and we are called to do it. That's what we're here for. That's what we exist for. Many of us, we don't exist for anything other than ourselves. We are a selfish society, are we not? Are we not a selfish society? If you didn't say yes, then you probably are part of that selfish society. We all are, right? We all are part of that selfish society. Well, that's not fair. I didn't get that, or I didn't get this, or I didn't get that. Life is not fair. I've heard that, man, all my life, you know. Life is not fair. You're right. It's not fair. I remember hearing we had a lady that served on the nominating committee. Some of you, if you're old staunch Baptist, remember the nominating committee. Yeah, man, those are wonderful. But we put this lady on that nominating committee because here's what she would do. She would go up to somebody and she would ask them to take a position in the church. And they would go, and she would go, let me just remind you how much Jesus died on that cross for you. He bled. Crown of thorns just, pow. And you can't even serve in the children's department. That's why she was the chairman of the nominating team. She could get anybody to do anything. He could walk up to her and say, we want you to serve here. People would see her coming and would bolt out windows. Third story windows, just boom, they're gone. She would do it. How much do you love? I love, she would come up to people and she'd walk up to you. How much do you love Jesus? That's a loaded question, man. I love him so much. Well, then he wants you. We are such a selfish society. But here's what we do. What we do is we just think, you know what? People are here to serve me. It's all about me. No. Are you willing to say, you know what? That's our job. We are called. We are sent. God has sent us to the masses with a message of salvation. Now, so here we go. I want you to see three items here. Number one is the message of the challenge. Number two is the method of the challenge. But now look at number three, meeting the challenge. Meeting the challenge. How do we meet that challenge? All right, well, let's look at it. Let's look at meeting that challenge because I want you to see verse number 16. However, they did not all heed the glad tidings, for Isaiah said, the Lord who has believed our report. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. How do we meet that challenge? Folks, we meet that challenge first by praying. By praying. Remember, I told you, our last message for the Let's Roll campaign that we've been doing, I hope you haven't forgotten that. I hope you hadn't just said, well, it's all over. He did six messages on it. Whoo, all right, no more. Listen, remember how we talked about in Let's Roll that we must pray, we must prepare, all of those things? You see, to meet the challenge, we got to pray. We got to pray that God will prick our hearts and give us a passion for lost people. A prayer that will absolutely revolutionize your thinking and my thinking, has mine, will revolutionize your ministry and your life, is this prayer right here. Dear God, let me see people the way that you do. Let me see people the way that you see people. We see people in different lights, don't we? We look at people. How many of you have ever just judged? You know, judging a book by its cover, you ever do that? How many of you have ever just looked at somebody and you've kind of just already had a judgment call on them? I will never forget one day. Dude come walking in my church, and he was huge. I'm talking like huge. Like Hulk Hogan, Rambo, all in one huge. And he had a long goatee, earrings, his head was just enormous. The whole time I'm preaching, I'm seeing him in the back. And the whole time I'm preaching, I'm going, I hope he's on my team. And the whole time I'm preaching, I'm thinking, all right, this dude pulled up in a Harley, had to. Big old truck or whatever, and he gets out. After service was over with, standing out front shaking hands, and he come walking by, I'm talking about his hands. His hand swallowed mine, and then he gripped. And I went, and I said, it's good to see you. And I said, let me introduce myself. And I introduced myself to him. And he opened his mouth with the highest pitched, squeaky voice I've ever heard in my life. And I went, that was anticlimactic. That didn't work. And got into a Chevy Impala, little bitty car, a family car and had a car seat in the back. And I'm like going, you ruined it. You ruined it. Sweetest guy I've ever met in my life. But you see what I did? You see what I did? Same thing we do. Look at somebody and go, yep, Remember, Hell's Angels, right there. Dude is right there. Drug addict. I'm sure he'd probably come by here on his way selling dope somewhere. I mean, we do that, don't we? We do that. But you know what? Let me give you a verse of Scripture. Write this down. You don't have to turn with it because I copied it out for you. Listen to this. 2 Peter 3:9. You ready for it? The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any would perish, but that all would come to repentance. Did you hear that? How do we meet that challenge? I love, and I told you, I love a challenge. And when Paul throws this out there, we have a challenge, don't we? We have a challenge. And here my question is this. Are you ready to meet that challenge? Are you ready to meet that challenge? You know what? I could stand up here and tell you these things and tell you these things and tell you these things. And I could stand up here and tell you how excited it is. Let me tell you this. The greatest feeling in the whole wide world is, I've had two of them. I had two wonderful feelings when my children were born. Trust me, they fade. They fade. Wonderful feeling when you're, that's not it. Winning a football game, winning a baseball game, that's not it. Going on that wonderful vacation that you had planned for all your life to go on, that's not it. Let me tell you, the greatest feeling that you will ever feel in all of your life is when you lead one person to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That is the greatest feeling that you will ever feel. Can I tell you this? Can I testify this morning? Well, I'm going to do it anyway. But here is what I'm going to tell you. When you lead somebody to Christ, you are more excited about it than when you came. You may tell you the reason why? Because you understand what Jesus has saved them from. Leading one to Christ is what it's about. Leading it to Christ. You know what? I love a challenge. I love a challenge. And I'm going to leave you with this right here. It's Lauren.
Great moments are born from great opportunity.
You shouldn't have any doubt in your mind about what you're supposed to do tonight and about how you're supposed to do it.
This is your time.
Now, I don't want them to gain another yard.
We gotta go out there and we gotta take it.
Take their game and you shove it right back in their face.
That's how winning is done.
Team is something you belong to, something you feel, something you have to earn.
If we don't come together, it's over.
And I guarantee a week won't go by in your life you won't regret walking out, letting them get the best of it.
I'll ask you one last time.
To be the best that you can be.
Play like champions.
Win.
It's about heart. It's about who can go out there and play the hardest.
It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward.
I don't care what the scoreboard says. At the end of the game, in my book, we're going to be winners.
In any fight, it's the guy who's willing to die.
Willing to take the hits.
Who's going to win that itch.
Let me tell you something, you don't let anything. Nothing. Come between us.
On this team, we fight.
And we shut them down because we can't.
ready for the challenge? As in the immortal words, and this is Olympic season. Do you believe in miracles? I hope that every one of you, man. Every time I was putting that together, I was watching that thing, and every time I watched it, just gave me a chill, man. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. Are you ready to go? How about the challenge? Are you ready to meet the challenge? Are you? Yeah, Pastor. Let's go meet the challenge. I hope you're ready to meet the challenge. I want you to bow your head with me this morning. Father, we just come before you, Lord.